In this video, we're going to look at how we can use the StatCrunch calculators to get various p-values, basically. We're going to look at how we can use these calculators in place of tables and other things to give us areas under our various distribution curves. So if we go up here in StatCrunch to Stat Calculators, you'll see that there is a whole slew of calculators we can use. Some of the ones we're going to use most frequently is going to be the chi-square one. We're going to use that one a lot because that's a really hard distribution to get accurate p-values out of tables because of degrees of freedom. The normal distribution, you can pretty much use tables fairly accurately for that, but we'll still go over that one really quick. And then the t-table, again, because of degrees of freedom, it's much easier and much more accurate to use this versus a table. Okay, so let's look at chi-square first, because that's the one that we're going to kind of use the most with this method. The great thing about these calculators is we can use them in both directions. And what I mean is, if you, let's say by hand, computed a chi-square test statistic, then you can plug it in here and get the corresponding probability. And vice versa, if they give you a probability and ask you to figure out the cutoff point, then you can use this for that as well. Now let's go back to the normal curve, because we'll relate it back to something that we understand, and then see how to apply it to the other ones. Okay, so let's standard normal curve, right? Mean of 0, standard deviation of 1. You'll see that the red stuff is half, 0.5, of the curve, and that occurs whenever we're looking for a probability where our test statistic, right, our x, is less than or equal to 0. If we can change this to greater than or equal to 0, we get the same amount because, duh, the thing is symmetrical. Okay, let's say you're computing a two-tailed test, right, a two-tailed z-test, and your confidence level is going to be 95%. Then that means your alpha level is 5%, but because you're doing a two-tailed, you only want 2.5%, right, in each tail. So if you want to figure out what your cutoff is, right, you want to find what that z critical is. And yes, I know we have these memorized, hopefully at this point, or we can look in our tables really quickly. But if you wanted to figure it out, if you put 0.025, because 0.025, and then compute, you'll notice, okay, here's the little red tail because it's doing an upper, and that's 2.5%, and the corresponding z critical score, right, the cutoff, is 1.959964. And I know most of you are probably thinking, oh, wasn't the answer we used 1.96? Yes, it is, but that's because we rounded up. This one is a little bit more accurate. Okay? And then if you wanted to do the lower tail, then you would just change it and you would get the lower one. Right? If we change it, you'll notice that when you change it, it keeps your x and it changes your p-value, right? And now all of this is shaded, and there's 97.5. But if you now change this to 0.025, you'll see that you get the negative version of the same thing. Okay, and this works for all normal, not just standard normal. We can now have a mean of, let's say, 100, and a standard deviation of, let's say, 8. Like maybe we're looking at IQ scores. And we want to know what IQ score is going to put us in the, let's say, we want to be in the 97th percentile. Right? So we want to have a cutoff of 97. So the average IQ score was 100, the standard deviation was 8. We want to know what's going to put us in the 97th percentile. So we're basically saying, what score do we have to get such that's going to be the probability is, you know, above 97%. We compute that, and here is what you think. Well, does that look right? No, because remember, if we want to be in the 97th percentile, we're not looking for the cutoff that gives us 97%. right? Because this is a greater than. This is the probability that our score is greater than. So if we're in the 97th percentile, doesn't that mean we only have 3% above us? And now, doesn't the picture look better, right? Oh, that looks more likely, right? The little red tail, and we want to be up here. So we need an IQ of 115.05, let's say, to be in the 97th percentile. Okay, so that's the beauty of these calculators. We can also do betweens by clicking on the between button, and now we can say, what's the probability that somebody has an IQ between 90 and 105? Here's the picture, 90 to 105. You can see 100 is still the average, and that's roughly 63%. Okay, so it's a great quick way of doing in-betweens, greater thans, and less thans. And it works the same for all of our other distributions. So if we go calculator chi-square, I'll put these kind of side by side so you can see how they're very similar, right? The only difference is this doesn't have the 68, 95, 99.7 because, right, we don't have those on other than the normal curve. So now we've got our chi-square, and you know, we're checking to see if a distribution of numbers matches another distribution. So we're kind of doing a goodness of fit. And let's say we had 7 categories of numbers. Well, then our degrees of freedom is going to be 7 minus 1, which is 6. And let's say we did the calculations and we came up and we got a chi-square value of like 14.65, right? That's our test statistic. That's what we actually calculated. We do a greater than because we always do a greater than test. We compute it, and then there is the tail, right? You can see the picture matches what we're doing because we're always doing a greater than. We're doing a goodness of fit. And we're seeing that if we get a 14.65 as our test statistic, as our chi-square, that has a corresponding p-value of 0.023, blah, 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 blah. And now we can figure out if we reject or not depending on what our alpha level is, right? And then we can also go the other way and say, all right, well, if we have 7 categories, right, so our degree of freedom is 6, and we're going to test this thing at, let's say we want to test it at some weird thing. We're going to test it at the 92 percent, right? Then we set alpha to be 8. And any chi-square above 11.28 is now going to be in the rejection region, okay? If we wanted to do in-between, here's the in-between, and now we can have our two chi-square values, right? And then it gives us the percentage in between them. And then the exact same thing is going to happen for the t's, because we also work with the t distribution, and you can see that it's just like the others. It starts you with standard, which means it starts you with choosing either a less than or a greater than, right? You've got to give it your degrees of freedom. If you give it, in this case, a t score, it gives you a corresponding, let's give a smaller one so you can actually see it. It's still too big. All right. There we go. You can see the shading, and then you can verify that, oh yeah, I was doing an upper tailed test, so this is the right way. Or if I was doing a lower tailed test, then this is how much area, and I get a much bigger, right, p-value. Or maybe I'm doing an in-between test, and so then I've got to type these things in and do the two numbers, and it gives me the corresponding p-value. Or maybe I want to find a test statistic based on a p-value. So if I have, let's say, 11 things, so I've got a degree of freedom of 10, and I want to know what is my cutoff for being 95% accurate, right? I want to do a kind of like the 68, 99, or 95, 99.7 thing. So what are my cutoffs for being 0.95? Well, it doesn't work that way, right? You can't do the in-between backwards. The in-between will only let you type these two numbers in, and it will give you the corresponding probability. If you want to work backwards from the probability, you have to go back to standard. You have to treat it like a one-tailed test, But now, depending on which way you want to do it, right, below or above, let's just do above because I think it's easier. If we want a 95% confidence interval, that means we have 5% in the two tails, which means we have 2.5%, right, in each tail. So if you just change this to 2.5%, here is my cutoff, 2.228. That's going to be the critical value for the upper end of my 95% confidence. And then because it's symmetrical, we know the lower one is negative. Okay, so those are all the different ways we can use the StatCrunch calculators to come up with p-values and critical values, depending on if we're doing t's, z's, or chi-squares. And it also works for a lot of other things, right? It also works for the F distribution, which you might work with in some classes. And then all these others, the binomial you probably use every now and then, the Poisson, the hypergeometric. It's great. It's a fantastic tool. Once you know how to use one of them, they all work relatively the same way. It's just, type in degrees of freedom that you need, type in your test statistic. They always list it as an X, even though in this case we're doing an F, right? Never. And then it gives you the corresponding probability, or vice versa. You give it a probability and it gives you the corresponding test statistic. Okay, hope that helps.